Those of you who have watched my Q&A video know that my background is in photosynthesis research, so I want to convince you that photosynthesis is fascinating. So I've come up with some quick nuggets of information that you probably don't know about photosynthesis. So indulge me for just a few minutes and I'll try and convince you. Photosynthesis is the process that plants and other photosynthetic organisms, such as algae and cyanobacteria, used to produce sugar from water, carbon dioxide, and light. It is responsible for almost all life on Earth. If you follow a food chain back far enough, you will almost always find a photosynthetic organism of some form as the primary producer of the system. Even creatures that don't rely on photosynthesis for food can be reliant on the byproduct of photosynthesis, oxygen. The first steps of photosynthesis involve the production of this oxygen. Water is split into oxygen and hydrogen by the enzyme photosystem 2. Yes, in photosynthesis, 2 comes before 1, because that is the order that these enzymes were discovered. The splitting of water, however, is no small task. It is the most thermodynamically challenging reaction in all of biology. To put this into perspective, water can be split with heat. For example, at 2200 degrees Celsius, about 3% of all water molecules will disassociate into oxygen and hydrogen. But in leaves, with the help of photosystem 2, this can occur at anything above zero. The energetics involved here do present some problems. Water splitting results in the production of reactive oxygen species that damage the proteins in the cell. The core protein of photosystem 2, known as D1, has a half-life in a growing plant of just 2 hours, meaning that the plant must constantly replace its photosynthetic machinery. Oxygen itself was not all good news. When oxygenic photosynthesis first evolved in cyanobacteria, it caused massive climate change and the mass extinction of life forms that couldn't deal with this new aerobic atmosphere. This is known as the Great Oxygenation Event, and there is some debate about the exact timeline. Not too surprising, since this happened 2.3 billion years ago. But to simplify, the oxygen produced by early cyanobacteria was initially absorbed by minerals such as iron in the Earth's crust. But after this mass rusting, these sinks were overpowered, and oxygen levels in the atmosphere slowly rose from almost zero to today's 21%. Cyanobacteria had polluted the atmosphere with corrosive and reactive oxygen, resulting in a mass extinction of countless species of anaerobic bacteria that were unable to survive in this new oxygen-rich atmosphere. As well as oxidizing atmospheric methane, a powerful greenhouse gas, plunging the planet into the longest snowball Earth period in the geological timeline, lasting between 300 and 400 million years. But it also opened the door for the evolution of aerobic respiration, allowing much more energy to be accessed by life. That in turn allowed for more complex life to evolve. You know, like cats for starring in YouTube videos, and humans for making YouTube videos. You probably know that plants are green because of the pigment chlorophyll. This is the pigment that plants use to absorb light. The energy from this light is used in photosynthesis to produce the sugars that the plant needs. You might even know that plants make use of two types of this pigment, imaginatively named chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B. These chlorophylls absorb slightly different wavelengths of light from each other. These are the only two chlorophylls found in plants. But zoom into the microbial world, and there are other chlorophylls out there. The most recently discovered is chlorophyll F. This was found in stromatolites from Shark Bay in Western Australia. The function of this chlorophyll F in photosynthesis is unknown, as is its ecological distribution, but it has been revealed to be the most redshifted chlorophyll yet discovered, absorbing light in the infrared range. And its chemical structure is very similar to chlorophyll A. This has led to speculation that chlorophyll F could be introduced into crop plants to allow the plants to access a larger range of the light spectrum, potentially increasing crop yields. However, adding chlorophyll to plants isn't the only idea for increasing crop yields. In fact, doing the opposite and taking away chlorophyll can, paradoxically, also increase yields. The plant's leaves are very, very good at absorbing the wavelengths of light that can be used for photosynthesis. However, only a fraction of the energy absorbed is used. The remaining energy is lost, mostly in the form of heat, in a process called non-photochemical quenching, but a little is lost as light through chlorophyll fluorescence. But with leaves so efficient at absorbing light, often the upper leaves absorb so much light that there is not enough light left for the leaves further down in the canopy to perform photosynthesis at maximum efficiency. In a natural forest, there is an advantage to denying a competitive plant these resources, but in a monoculture crop, we are less interested in the individual's performance and more concerned with the performance of the crop in total and the amount of delicious things we can get. So reducing the chlorophyll content in the crop's leaves can allow more leaves to be working at peak efficiency, resulting in an overall higher yield. So there you go, some quick nuggets of information that you now know about photosynthesis. Let me know in the comments below if I convinced you that photosynthesis is fascinating.